Welcome to Lecture Online. So let's talk a little bit about density, the ultimate density, infinite density. Of course, when a neutron star collapses into a black hole, the idea is that all that mass disappears into zero volume. And of course, density is mass over volume. If you had zero volume, you get infinite density. But let's take a look at it from a little different perspective. Not that this is exactly the way things happen, because we really don't know what happens once we get into the realm of a black hole, but at least it gives us kind of an idea. It's kind of an interesting idea as well. So let's say that we have a neutron. A neutron is made up of one up and two down quarks. And there's some forces in between that prevent the quarks from getting pushed closer together and prevents the quarks from being pulled apart. So the formation of a neutron is a very powerful and very strong formation, very difficult to destroy a neutron. However, when you have a neutron inside a neutron star and you have all that enormous amount of weight pushing down on it, there's a limit to how much a neutron can withstand. And at some point, we believe that the neutron will get crushed and somehow the structure of a neutron will change. Now, notice that the radius of a neutron is about 0.8 times 10 to the minus 15 meters. And the radius of a quark is about 0.43 times 10 to the minus 18 meters. So if we compare the radius of a neutron to the radius of a quark, we get about a 2,000 to 1 relationship. In other words, the radius or diameter of a neutron is about 2,000 times the radius or diameter of a quark. Can you imagine three tiny little objects, like three quarks that are just 1/2,000 the size of a neutron, together they make up a neutron. Very, very strange. We don't quite understand that yet, how that works. We just know that it does. And then if you compare volumes, the volume of a neutron divided by the volume of a quark, of course, we have to then take the radius and cube it, because the volume of a sphere is the radius cubed. We have a ratio of 8 billion to 1. And of course, since there's three quarks, if we compare the volume of a neutron to the volume of three quarks, it is almost 3 billion to 1. So the volume of a neutron is basically 3 billion times the volume of the three quarks that make up the neutron. Then there's something else that's really strange. When we start looking at the mass of an up quark and the mass of a down quark and the mass of a neutron, and we compare them, of course, we can express the mass in terms of the energy divided by c squared, because notice that E, the energy, equals mc squared, which means we can express the mass in terms of the energy divided by c squared. So we can convert the energy from joules into what we call electron volts. In this case, m stands for million electron volts. So here we express the mass of these particles in terms of energy over the c squared, which is a very common way of doing that. So now let's compare that. We have a mass of an up quark at 2 MeV and the mass of a down quark at 4.8 MeV. And of course, you need two of these and one of those. And the mass of a neutron is 939.5 MeV. So when we compare the mass of a neutron divided by the mass of the three quarks, we get a ratio of 81 to 1. So you have three particles that have a certain amount of mass together. When you put it together, you end up with a particle that has 81 times the mass of the three particles together. So 3 billion times the volume, 81 times the mass. How does that work? No one really knows. But there's something there that caused that to happen when you have the structure of a neutron. Now what happens when you crunch down the neutron and you crunch down the volume of these enormous quantum neutrons down into its individual components, quarks, so that you end up with a quark star. Although we're not saying that's what happens, just imagine that if it did. And then you convert the volume of a neutron into the volume of all those quarks, and a sphere of a diameter of 20 kilometers would then go down into a sphere of only 10 meters. Is basically the size of a house. Wow. Something the size that's 20 kilometers across crunches down to the size of a house. Now, is that what the singularity is of a black hole? We don't think so, because we no longer think that quarks or neutrons or anything stays the way it is. Something changes to the laws of physics when you get down into a black hole, and essentially what we think is it crunches down to infinite size or infinite small size, down to basically zero volume. But then strangely enough, even if this were to happen, if this was to go from neutrons to quarks, the mass would change tremendously. And what we do notice is that the mass doesn't change. Somehow the mass remains even though the volume goes to an infinitely small volume. So we know that this is not exactly what's going on, but it's interesting to compare it and then to realize, well, I don't think we end up with a quark star. We end up simply with a black hole that essentially has zero volume, and the mass that started the collapse of the gravitational collapse, that mass is still there because what happens around the black hole still appears as if it obeys the concept that the mass hasn't disappeared. And essentially, that gives us also a better idea about the concept of ultimate density and the concept of a black hole. And that is how we do it.
Are you sure there's nothing else inside a neutron besides quarks?
I don't think that quarks remain quarks once we get it squished down to that size. I think the force of gravity are too strong that even quarks can't survive.
So what does quarks become? Does something make quarks?
We have no idea. We think quarks may be the ultimate particle, but then how do you get down to zero volume? Because if it had a quark star, it'd still be 10 meters across. Although we would never know because we can't look inside a black hole to actually go find out. And if it turned into quarks, does that mean it then the mass changed to only 181th? How do you say that? 1 over 81 times the original mass of the neutron star? Doesn't make a lot of sense either. So we don't know.
So we used to think that the electrons...
Oh yeah, and then of course, I didn't mention the electrons. And the protons. It's hard to know. We don't really know. Okay, that's number 2.